Welcome to Rolling Stone's 500 Greatest Songs, a podcast based on Rolling Stone's hugely popular, influential, and sometimes controversial list. I'm Brittany Spanos.
And I'm Rob Sheffield. We are here to shed light on the greatest songs ever made and discover what makes them so great.
We have a very important songwriter and producer to talk about today. Very special episode. We'll be discussing Max Martin and his contributions to the 500 Greatest Songs list, of which he has four songs on the list. There is Backstreet Boys' I Want It That Way and Taylor Swift's Blank Space. But today, we're going to talk very specifically about the song Baby One More Time by Britney Spears. I mean, there are so many artists on the list that he has worked with in different capacities. I mean, there are very few pop artists who have not had a session in Sweden with Max Martin and his kind of group of songwriters and producers that he works with. Of course, he's worked with Ariana Grande and Adele, Backstreet Boys, Robin, Celine Dion, NSYNC, Demi Lovato, Selena Gomez,
Katy Perry,
Pink. I mean, it's like it's a big deal if you don't work with Max. It's almost as big of a story to not work with him.
Yeah. It's like, what's wrong with you if you don't, you know?
And he's had 25 number one hits that he has written or produced, or both. And he has 5 Grammys, his first Grammy ever. Didn't come until he worked with Taylor Swift. But I mean, that kind of figures into a lot of what we'll probably talk about, a lot of the music that he's worked on and how we're giving it its due as the years go by. And one of the fun facts about Max that I learned while researching this is that he was in a hair metal band that kicked off his career called It's Alive. I actually had no idea that was the background of how he was originally signed. And then he ended up starting to work on Dennis Pop's label, and Dennis Pop took him under his wing because he realized he had this, you know, brilliant pop mind, which was very smart. And then lo and behold, the Backstreet Boys come calling. And that's when Max gets his really big break as a pop songwriter, is working with the Backstreet Boys on their self-titled debut in 1996. He worked on Quit Playing Games with My Heart, which hit number 2 on the Hot 100 and was a big moment for both Backstreet Boys, Max Martin, for pop music, and kind of set the tone for years to come to this day.
Unbelievable. And Max Martin, what was he, like 24 at that point?
Yeah,
he was barely older than the Backstreet Boys. The stereotype is, you know, the young, hungry boy band, and then the manipulative Svengali figure. He was like just their age. It's crazy how young he was when he like began this whole Swedish hair metal as disco revolution that took over the pop world.
And the Backstreet Boys had their own Svengali to worry about. Max Martin didn't need to add to that. Yeah.
He was literally the least of their problems. Yeah.
And the placement of the songs that are on the list, we have Blank Space at 357, which we have a whole episode where we're going to talk about that song because, of course, we have to. Backstreet Boys' I Want It That Way comes in at 240. Britney Spears' Baby One More Time comes in at 205. And Kelly Clarkson's Since You've Been Gone clocks in at number 93, hits the top 100.
I guess I'm curious, since you go way, way back with like the pop artists that he began with, what was your sort of Max Martin origin story?
It was definitely Backstreet Boys. I think like what's great about that late 90s pop boom that Max was so ingratiated in was that was when I was 6 to 9, you know, like this was the time when I was really formulating my own personality and taste in music.
Amazing. Well, that the whole Carson TRL era, unthinkable without Max Martin, who everybody got to know his name because he was on so many hits, but it's wild that he was such a behind-the-scenes personality.
And still is.
Yeah.
Yeah, he is very press shy. He doesn't talk about his work very much. Very rarely, I mean, doesn't do interviews at all. As much as he's such a major presence, like that is a name brand person, that's someone that like everyone knows. Max Martin, if you love pop music, you know that name and you're very familiar with it. So he's like such a larger than life presence in pop music, but he still kind of stays very silent and stays behind the scenes and stays away from it and really lets the artist kind of build that narrative around the songs and around who they are and kind of how they fit into it. And, you know, every once in a while we'll get kind of glimpses into his creative process from the artist talking about it. But for the most part, he's just very... He kind of just stays out, minds his business. And that's why he writes great pop songs. He minds his business.
Absolutely. He had never had any interest at all in being a celebrity producer. He just, he didn't want anybody to know his face or his voice or his ideas.
Yeah.
It was always about the artist and the song.
And I mean, all the artists that he works with and was such a part of their careers, and I mean, both in terms of the star-making moments that he's been a huge part of, but also for the shifts in people's own sort of musical sounds and their own kind of careers. He's been such a big part of every turning point for a lot of the biggest names in pop music over the last nearly three decades that he's been working. All these songs speak so much for themselves, so you don't really need him to weigh in, even though obviously we are nerdy about that and would love to hear more from him and would love to hear him talk about that process and things like that. But yeah, I mean, those songs so speak for themselves and change pop music for, I mean, again, we still are hearing the reverberations of what he started to do with the Backstreet Boys and on today. Everyone tries to get that sound.
Absolutely. And has never sounded dated. None of these songs sound like oldies.
Yeah.
The Backstreet Boys songs, it's funny that those were just a little before Britney blew up.
Yeah.
Britney Spears, the other Britney. But it's wild that even then it was such a distinctive sound. Like, you were a fan, you were right on the ground floor with the Backstreet Boys.
Yeah, I mean, just the combination of genres, obviously there's so much of that Euro pop, Euro dance sound that was taking over the clubs in the 90s and was such a big part of dance music and kind of the underground music of that time. But there's so much of that R&B sound because all of these bands and these artists who were singing his songs were such big fans of the R&B music of the time. Backstreet Boys were imitating New Edition, and Britney Spears was such a fan of Mariah and Janet and every, you know, just any, and Whitney Houston and every R&B singer of the 90s. So you kind of hear that so much in the melodies that he's doing, and like the actual kind of beats are so Euro dancey and kind of like Euro trashy kind of dance music, which is great. Something I love a lot. And yeah, like a little bit of New Jack Swing in some of the songs, and especially in the ballads. And so it's kind of an interesting fusion that he was playing with that worked really well because it meshed so much with what these artists were wanting to do musically anyway, like who they were as vocalists, and let that shine on a lot of these songs.
Yeah. And of course, Baby One More Time with Britney Spears, I think that's probably when people started to say, okay, there's this producer in Stockholm who's got this sound, because the Backstreet Boys songs, they were huge, but the fact that, you know, Britney Spears came out of nowhere with this just absolutely massive song. I mean, the Euro pop and R&B you mentioned, but also so much metal in his production style, which is why it's so wild what you say about his Swedish hair metal roots, because there really is that apocalyptic bam, 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 and everything he produced.
It nods to the 80s without feeling overtly 80s in a lot of ways. All the songs are very like bombastic and very like big, which is great.
When Rolling Stone, when we did our list of the greatest debut singles of all time, Baby One More Time was an easy pick for number one. It's the perfect example of a song that comes out of nowhere and introduces not just a new artist, but a new aesthetic and a new approach to the sonic architecture of pop music. And you definitely remember where you were the first time you heard that song.
Yeah.
And you probably said, what the hell is this?
Do you remember the first time you heard it?
Yes, I do. It was December 98, and it was that song, and it was hearing it on MTV, and it sounded so alien, so robotic, which was a really bizarrely distinctive thing about the Max Martin sound.
Yeah.
And I said, where the hell is this song coming from? And I thought, I cannot tell where this singer is from on the planet. Like, it might be Euro, it might be US, but it could be anywhere. And I said, I cannot tell if this singer is old or young. I can't tell anything. It's just this amazing, bombastic, like you said, thunderous, apocalyptic kind of sound. It was mind-blowing to hear it for the first time and realize this is something we'd never heard anything that sounded like this before.
Yeah. I really love a detail that Britney had given around that time of wanting to imitate Soft Cell's Tainted Love in the vocal.
that was when I interviewed her.
Yeah.
And I had so many questions about that song.
Yeah.
And she said, I wanted to get that Tainted Love sound. And she said, like, that's what I was going for, that sort of new wave sound. And she said, I wanted my voice to sound like that. So she said, I didn't want to get any sleep, so I stayed up, stayed out very late the night before. And she said, I kept telling myself, Brittany, don't get any sleep because you want that raspy growl in your voice. And she definitely got that.
It works so well on it.
It sure does. Soft Cell must have been so honored.
Thinking about how every pop star has tried to imitate that over the years is so incredible. Like, that is a song that everyone wants a Baby One More Time moment when they come out the gate, of course, and like they want that, you know, it's their big pop moment, but there's no one else who could have delivered it the way that Britney Spears had done. Because even like Max had offered it to Backstreet Boys at first and TLC, and they had been sort of possibly going to be the ones singing that song, and then both rejected it, and then it went to Britney Spears, who loved it immediately.
Absolutely. I firmly believe that if either of those artists had recorded the song, Britney's version is still the one we would know. It would have been just as big because it was made for her and she for it. It's so funny to think of TLC, who were adults, singing the song. It's like, no, this isn't a song for adult veterans to sing. This is a song for a new voice who's got something to say musically, sonically, and in every way.
Yeah. Yeah. The only regret about that is that I wish I could hear Left Eye's Baby One More Time verse.
you could definitely tell that, you know, that the TLC vocal influence.
Yeah.
But yeah, it would have been all wrong for a singer, as, you know, I mean, T-Boss was always super smart sounding singer. She never came on naive or confused. She was always super in control. It's something that just defines her power as a vocalist.
It just feels so perfectly in tune with everything that Britney loved and was kind of already a fan of in music, and then also kind of helped mold this like important phase of her career and kind of the way that we were introduced to her. In the video, of course, like that was her idea, to kind of be like, I'm a teenager, I'm singing for other teenagers, I'm going to be in a high school, where she went to the high school where they filmed Grease, as a big Grease fan that she was, and did that. I mean, it feels like so perfectly, like such a perfect teen idol pop moment in that way. That album just blew up so quickly, and so it's kind of, the song itself blew up so quickly, so it's kind of hard to even think of a time where it wasn't everyone that I knew of Britney Spears, or had like an opinion on her, or had, you know, were even just like arguing about like their favorite Britney songs and kind of all this, you know, all that stuff. But yeah, it's tough to imagine a time before like Britney was such a part of my own listening habits and of my own kind of music taste. And for all the acts that, again, like Max is so integral part of their careers as Backstreet Boys and NSYNC and Britney, and those are all artists that just immediately became in heavy rotation for
absolutely.
And next up, we will be joined by Rolling Stone senior writer Brian Hyatt. We're here with senior writer of Rolling Stone, Brian Hyatt. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
I know you're a big Max fan. I know you're a big Absolutely. Baby One More Time fan.
For sure.
You've spoken with so many artists, and especially artists that have some relationship with Max, right? What do you think it is about him that keeps, beyond, of course, the obvious of he has so many hits under his belt, so 25 number one singles, things like that. Like, why do people still call Max Martin above all else to make that special moment in their career?
Say that he's sort of cracked the mathematical code to writing pop songs. And then when you ask them to explain that, they start to, and nothing they ever say really makes sense to me. I think some of it has to do with the amount of repetition of bits of the melody. You know, you repeat this bit twice, but then change one note the third time. There's stuff like that. There's stuff that has to do with the syllables and thus the rhythm of the, you know, the rhythm of the melody. He occasionally does interviews, but he doesn't do interviews with people who know how this stuff works, who can be like, you know, basically, what do you mean? It's a scientific approach, A. And then B, I'll say the other thing is that, weirdly, like a lot of pop since like 98 or so, it's really bringing in so many rock influences into what we're calling pop. And he's was a big part of starting that as well. He was kind of a hair metal fan. He's a Springsteen fan. You can hear it on Baby One More Time. You can hear it on Oops, I Did It Again, which was tragically omitted from our list, but, you know, also one of the greatest songs of all time. It's like they can so easily just take out the synths and change them into heavy guitars, and you have a rock song, which of course so many people did, right? The ironic and then suddenly not ironic cover of Baby One More Time was such a phenomenon, as you remember, for indie bands at the time.
The Bowling for Soup version is very good, I must say. From
there was a Travis version. There was who else?
Richard Thompson did a great version. A shockingly great version.
That was when he was doing the entire history of popular music from like 1500 to that, right? Yeah.
The millennium in pop music. And like it ended with Baby One More Time. It like began with like, you know, medieval ballads. And there was something kind of beautiful about that because like these are, to a large extent, folk songs. Yeah. They travel, they have weird lives.
He thus proved, like, as they say in The Matrix, that 1999 was the peak moment of your human civilization, so that's like when 1,000 years of pop music peaked with Baby One More Time, and there really was, we've had all this nice music since then, but was there really any more need for songs after Baby One More Time?
We could have stopped right there.
Do you have a favorite Max Martin song?
I mean, the ones on the list, I mean, I Want It That Way is... Mm-hmm. I like Baby One More Time, the record, the recording, better. But I Want It That Way is just such an impeccable song. It might very well be that one. We all have a soft spot for It's My Life by Bon Jovi.
Great song. Tommy and Gina's sequel.
You know, one of the things that was so interesting about that is it was Max returning, just as I was saying, the fact that really he was kind of writing Bon Jovi songs, but like with the synth dress up. You know, the boy band or teen pop dress up. Mm-hmm. But then he just straight up went back and did a Bon Jovi song and proved that the formula was so durable. Both that and Since You've Been Gone, again, does the same thing that It's My Life does. It takes the implicit rock and makes it explicit.
Yeah.
I love the way Taylor Swift used him, which is she kind of worked with him and learned everything he had to teach. And then she's like, thank you. And then went on to do it without him. And then I think that she's one of the only artists who did it that way. And I think that that also says a lot about her, you know?
Yeah. What were your favorite songs, Rob, of the Max Martin canon?
Well, if I had to choose, and I do at this moment, my three would be Avril Lavigne's greatest song ever, What the Hell, from 2011.
Wow.
Her midlife crisis, living her life, 30-something post-divorce Avril. Absolutely perfect song. Every time I hear it, I think, this is the song that will outlive all the other Avril Lavigne songs. And it's such a bop. The Max Martin-ness of it is so huge, but he's, as always, he's really great at listening to these artists and what their voice is and what they're good at. And just as he did, I think it's her version of Bon Jovi's It's My Life. And then a song that I know we all love, Selena Gomez, Hands to Myself. I think it proves, if I may use this expression, that Max Martin is the metaphorical gin and juice. And Taylor Swift's New Romantics, which to me is the culmination for both of their careers. This is such a perfect peak for them to arrive at.
I mean, even on a song like, I feel like Break Free, I always think of as sort of like peak kind of recent years Max Martin, where it is
so
sort of that
good
kind of weird lyricism, that very like kind of Swedishisms that are in there, where you're like, now I've become who I really are, and you're like, this is such like a Britney Spears like 99 line that he's thrown in here on the Zed song.
How do you write songs in English for so many decades and refuse to learn?
But it's a great line. It works so well.
It's so great.
Like, now I've become who I really are, like that's stuck in my head constantly.
Like, again, we don't know who did what, but I refuse to believe Max Martin didn't write those himself, because you look at, you know, I Want It That Way, and it's mind-blowing that a song impeccable, like you said, and a song that's a standard and a classic that makes almost no sense, almost no phrase of the song connects with any other phrase of the song.
I think, like, I always really love how kind of casualness of it. Like, there is something that feels very, like, he just, like, wrote down a phone conversation he had with, like, an ex, like, 5 seconds before he started writing the song.
Absolutely. It's really amazing when you think of how many conversations begin. Here's the thing, and that song is, I mean, so many genius things about that song, but that it actually uses that to begin a conversation in a song.
Yeah, I mean, that song, it wasn't originally supposed to go to Kelly Clarkson either. It was originally Pink and then Hilary Duff.
Really?
Were the other two who almost got that song.
I had no idea.
I mean, Pink, you know, obviously her and Max have had a very long, ongoing collaborative relationship. They've worked on a ton of music together to this day, so that makes sense. But of course, Breakaway is, I would say, Kelly's classic album. Of course, this is an album that really, really helps her solidify who she is as a pop star. And I mean, Miss Independent was kind of a good precursor to what she would end up doing on like Breakaway, and Miss Independent from the Thankful era kind of helped maybe push her towards this like pop rock moment. But Since You've Been Gone, as the second single from that, being this like big, boisterous, like kind of like pop punky, pop rocky kind of moment from her with like these giant guitars and like this like booming voice that she has that works so well over it. I mean, there's no one else that can sing that song in the same way with Baby One More Time. Like, you know, even with the potential other artists who were going to sing that song first, it just makes so much sense with who ended up with it that I feel no remorse in losing a pink version of Since You've Been Gone, you know?
Yes, totally. And such a great moment where this sort of, this whole like school of New York, meet me in the bathroom era, like punk rock was finding its pop outlets. And that this is so perfect. Just even that they get that perfect drum sound from Fab Moretti of the Strokes, the sort of the Strokes hard to explain drum sound.
Yeah.
And the way it becomes the Yeah 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 song and the turnaround when it's exactly Brian Chase's drum sound. Yeah. And the, all these precise fan details are worked so perfectly into this song, but you don't have to know any of those references to respond to the song. It's as timeless as a breakup song can be.
Yeah.
I'm so moving on.
And I mean, the Yeah Yeah Yeahs did not like Since You've Been Gone very much.
I feel somewhere in their hearts, Beyonce and Hold Up must have opened them up to the idea of like their pop presence. But well, and Maps, you know, another one of the greatest songs of the century. But it's wild that so typical of Max Martin's genius to find stuff to use everywhere in pop music.
Yeah, and I found it fascinating that like in the 2010 version of the list, that kind of interim revamp that happened between the 2004 list and the 2021 list, Since You've Been Gone was ended up being added to that. And I mean, of course, that meant that within the few years that had been added, already been seen kind of immediately as one of the best songs that Max Martin had made thus far. But I'm curious, like, what you think in a future revamp of the list will be. It still feels kind of like a low number of his songs are represented on the list, but
That seems like I mean, I think Rob has a lot of later period candidates for that, you know.
That song that I'm sure we all love, So What, the Pink song. Mm-hmm. To me, it's funny that Pink has so many classics, but the Pink Max Martin collaborations are so unique for both of them. They really bring something out of each other. So What to me is like the pinnacle for what that collaboration achieves in terms of attitude and sound and and humor and rage and everything.
Yeah. In terms of other Max songs that should probably or hopefully will make the list in the future, like there are very few boy band songs on the list. And of course, I Want It That Way is on there. It's Gonna Be Me, another song that I was kind of surprised that we didn't have that NSYNC representation on the list at all, but especially It's Gonna Be Me.
Another Backstreet Boys song that no way reminds me of any Britney Spears song is Larger Than Life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Phenomenal song.
Yeah. And Everybody, that synth on Everybody is so, like the, you know, the beat on that is so good.
I remember it was a huge moment in terms of Max Martin becoming a recognized brand when Britney's You Drive Me Crazy and the Backstreet Boys, Larger Than Life, were hits at around the same time. People are like, I'm seeing a pattern here. But Larger Than Life is such a perfect, I mean, in so many ways, it's the ultimate boy band tribute to the audience.
Yeah.
And it's such a fantastic, bombastic song in every way.
Yeah. Yeah, and Brian mentioned Oops, I Did It Again, too, earlier in that song. Again, another Britney classic that could very easily make a future version of the list.
Yes, I thought the old lady put it at the bottom of the ocean. speaking of which, nothing was more confusing, I'm sure, to many kids than Backstreet's Back, All Right, when Backstreet Boys was to Americans at that point a new act. Obviously, they'd had a certain amount of bigness in Europe, but it was one of those things where, like, I think it almost had a sort of Inception effect on people being like, the sort of the Simpsons boy band with the subliminal message. It's like, well, they're back. I mean, I guess I already like them. I think that's the big secret to this.
I miss them so much.
Where have I been? How did I miss the whole Backstreet era? A phase of Max Martin's that we have to give love to because I know we all like feel deeply about this, but Katy Perry's star-making collaborations with Max Martin.
I mean, Katy Perry not being on the list is a travesty, but that's neither here nor there. I have my own.
We have to insert a Britney op-ed in there, like about.
Yeah,
this gigantic...
I mean, there was a lot of things that went wrong, but at the end of the day, we shouldn't be ignoring Teenage Dream or One of the Boys as classic albums. But I think because of what Max has been associated with, which was so much of this pop movement at the end of the 90s and early 2000s, pop movement that was seen as very manufactured, and these like artists that were Svengali'd, and these artists who like didn't have agency and things like that, or creative input. I do think that's obviously affected the way that people remember these songs, right? And remember and kind of give respect and due to what was created during that time. And I think, you know, we're seeing a little bit more of Max Martin as a songwriter and producer kind of get a little bit more respect as years go on. And I mean, his music's being celebrated on Broadway in the musical and Juliet, which is, I don't know if either of you guys have seen that, wacky time. I'm wondering, do you guys think that there's still even more due for him to be paid over the years as a songwriter and producer? Like, do you think that we still have kind of lost a little bit of that people really respecting his contributions to pop music, or do you think it's been properly bestowed upon him?
I think as time goes by, his legend will just rise, because none of these songs,
yeah.
You know, none of them are dated. None of them are oldies.
Yeah.
These are all songs that none of us would be surprised to hear on the radio today.
Yeah.
Like I said, I feel like those covers, there was a striking sort of acknowledgement from many people in the sort of indie world and the rock world and the singer-songwriter world that, whoa, these songs are really well written. Like right away, mm-hmm. there was sort of this, like I said, all those covers, and it was immediate. There were all these acoustic covers of Baby One More Time, which didn't happen with like any random pop yeah. song. And it didn't happen with ones that it should have, like, you know, I mean, where's the love for all those great Ashley Simpson songs? Like no indie band's ever covered them to this day. So it doesn't always happen. It's some, you know, there's often that barrier, but something about just, there's a level of craft, I think, that you can have where it's just, it overcomes those kind of genre prejudices. So I feel like kind of since the beginning, at least in maybe some critics for sure, a number of critics, and then definitely like musicians, songwriters were like, whoa, this guy's like, and that's sort of why even, you know, people who were songwriters, like, you know, like the great Bon Jovi, but like, you know, Bon Jovi, who was a songwriter, I mean, he was like, I have to work with this guy, because I, you know, he's cracked something. And you do hear about people studying, who aren't necessarily in the pop world, kind of studying that melodic math and trying. So I think he's got that love, couldn't have more love for musicians and songwriters already. And then I think critics have mostly caught up. So I think he's, you know, he's an absolute legend already for yeah. sure.
Well, thank you so much, Brian.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Thanks so much for listening to Rolling Stone's 500 Greatest Songs. This podcast is brought to you by Rolling Stone and iHeartMedia, written and hosted by me, Brittany Spanos, and Rob Sheffield. Executive produced by Jason Fine, Alex Dale, and Christian Horde, and produced by Jesse Cannon, with music by Eric Zeiler.